ACMI productions are only made possible with your support. Visit patreon.com/ACMI to learn how you can help. The following program is brought to you by Arlington Community Media, where we tell your story.
This is ACMI News, recognized nationwide as the first place winner of the 2023 Hometown Media Award for News Access.
Arlington residents gather to seek solutions to the ongoing problem with gas leaks. Nearly 200 gas leaks were tallied in Arlington last year alone, and these folks want to eliminate the potential dangers. Get ready for the largest Battle of Menotomy reenactment in Arlington ever, and that's just for starters. We talked to Arlington's deputy town manager and a host of historians about what we can expect this year. And the Regent Theatre celebrates this holiday season with the stars of the movie Jesus Christ Superstar and Saturday Night Fever. And judging from the crowd's reaction, everything's all right. Everything's fine. ACMI News starts right now.
From McLennan Park to Spy Pond, from Poets Corner to the Mystic River, we have Arlington covered, giving you stories that count from people who care. Reliable, trustworthy, dependable. This is the nationwide award-winning ACMI News.
It's no secret gas leaks have been a major concern throughout Arlington, and the smell of the methane gas, which at times can be downright obnoxious if not dangerous, will only get worse as temperatures begin to rise. Hello, I'm David Palomar.
And I'm Summer Maxwell. Thanks so much for joining us. According to National Grid, the gas utility company in Arlington, there were nearly 200 gas leaks in town around this time last year, which is why the group Mothers Out Front of Arlington wants as many residents as possible to learn about the ongoing gas leaks and how all of us can safely transition away from leaky gas to clean heat.
They held an event at the Robbins Library on Wednesday, April 3rd, called From Gas Leaks to Clean Heat, Making the Transition.
Those attending were brought up to speed on the movement to replace old hazardous gas infrastructure with new fossil fuel-free technologies, which promise to provide our neighborhoods with clean heating and cooling.
I think it's really important as residents to be educated about the fact that your money is being used to repair these leaks, and we know that that's actually not working. So the gas companies are spending lots and lots of money that we pay. They get a 10% return on all of that infrastructure that they're building. And our sense is what they want to do is replace all the gas pipes between now and 2050, so we have a shiny new gas system that A, we can't afford, and B, we can't use anymore because our climate laws don't allow us to burn natural gas.
So these immediate safety issues of gas leaks are pollutants, they kill trees, they kill plants, they sometimes explode houses. In the long run, what we're really dealing with here is climate change, which is causing more and more storms, floods, droughts, fires, everything that's happening on a more and more frequent basis, and with billion-dollar damages happening over and over and over again.
We have to triage those gas leaks that are the most crucial, but then we have to really have a plan, an organized plan to transition away from fossil fuels. This is what the legislature has said by 2050. This is what Arlington has, a net zero plan for 2050. We have to be thinking in terms of like the whole picture.
We want them to fix the dangerous leaks, and then we want them to get smart about how do you transition off the gas system. And so thinking about, are there neighborhoods that we could cut off and electrify? So rather than fixing that gas system that's super leaky, which will be really expensive, let's instead invest in electrification. Get those homes tight, get those homes on air source heat pumps or ground source heat pumps like geothermal, and trim the gas system. So we need the gas systems, the electrical, and the electric utilities to plan together for how they're going to make this change.
This event is sponsored by Mothers Out Front Arlington, Sustainable Arlington, and Equitable Arlington. For more information about the leaks and what Mothers Out Front is doing about it, visit the website mothersoutfront.org. Again, that's mothersoutfront.org.
Arlington's annual Candidates Night took place at Town Hall on Wednesday, March 27th, and was carried live right here on ACMI. This year's event was sponsored by the groups Envision Arlington and the League of Women's Voters of Arlington. Questions for candidates running for townwide office were solicited from the public. This year, all candidates running for key offices, including select board and school committee, are incumbents. The annual town election is set for April 6. Polls will be open from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. For a complete list of certified candidates in this year's town election, including those running for key townwide offices and town meeting, all you have to do is go to the town website, arlingtonma.gov/elections. Again, that's arlingtonma.gov/elections. If you couldn't be there for candidates night and you want to check it out, just go to our YouTube page, youtube.com/ACMITV. That's youtube.com/ACMITV. Again, polls open from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m.
Our trusty ACMI News wildlife photographer did it again. Through the years, we've been showing you some great photographs and video of our natural surroundings, courtesy of wildlife enthusiast John Harrison. Well, last week, he got to spend some time with several coyotes in an area cemetery, all from a safe distance, of course. John tells us he got to spend more than an hour with several coyotes. Now, we are at the tail end of coyote mating season, when coyotes are especially active. They are in every city and town in mainland Massachusetts, meaning the opportunity for human-coyote interaction is high. So, to protect yourself, make sure you secure and stash all your trash. Coyotes generally won't go near your residence if you consistently cut off their food supply. Also, coyotes can't differentiate between their natural prey and small pets, so they will view unprotected outdoor cats and small dogs as a potential food source. Arlington's animal control officer says, supervise your pets at all times while outdoors, and make sure your pet is on a leash. And as always, we thank John for these incredible images.
Arlington is about to embark on a great adventure this month. As part of the Arlington 250 celebration, we will be seeing the largest reenactment of the Battle of Menotomy ever on April the 14th. More on that in a minute. But first, there are many events leading up to the epic battle that you might want to take in, starting with a little historic imbibing.
We have Tavern Week, which we will have a number of our Arlington restaurants participating and offering different specials, and we'll be highlighting all of those restaurants on our website, as well as the Visit Arlington 250 website as well. We also have a beer hall scheduled for Saturday. We're partnering with Menotomy Tavern and Arlington Beer Company, and we're going to be offering a family-friendly day-long beer hall, which will be turning Arlington Town Hall into Menotomy Tavern, which back in the 1700s was a real tavern. We also have a number of bands participating and some other acts that will be joining us for sort of like a commercial for next year, just to get excited for the 250th, which we're pretty honored to be able to celebrate here in Arlington.
And hats off to Deputy Town Manager Christine Bongiorno, who is coordinating so many special Patriots Day events this year. Now to the Battle of Menotomy. This year's Patriots Day reenactment will be by far the biggest one yet. 200 to 250 reenactors are expected to pour into Arlington, which is sure to inflame the British beyond measure. They will be more than inflamed once the townsfolk greet the Brits on their way back to Boston. What exactly happened in the Battle of Menotomy, and why was the battle so significant? We take you back 249 years with the help of three noted Arlington historians.
Mid-April 1775, roughly 700 British Army regulars in Boston were given orders to capture and destroy colonial military supplies reportedly stored by the Massachusetts militia at Concord. Now, if they could capture Samuel Adams and John Hancock, complete thorns in the side of King George III, well, that would just be icing on the cake in this particular mission. The British began their trek late at night out of Boston, crossed the Charles River, and marched through Cambridge, then entered the village of Menotomy, now, of course, modern-day Arlington, to get to Lexington and eventually Concord, just 11 miles away. The Redcoats would suffer more casualties than they had anticipated on April the 19th, 1775, in the battles of Lexington and Concord. And since they only had one day's supply of food and ammunition, they abandoned the idea of capturing Adams and Hancock and began to hightail it back to Boston as soon as possible. To do that, they had to use the very same route on the return trip back to Boston. But after Paul Revere's warning just hours before, along with William Dawes, Samuel Prescott, and a host of other riders lost to history and the battles that had just occurred, it was game on as far as the Colonials were concerned. They knew what the Redcoats were up to and continued to pour into Arlington from neighboring communities and the countryside. They would then wait for the exhausted Redcoats to march by. And what happened later in the day, right here along Massachusetts Avenue, would outdo the battles of Lexington and Concord in its sheer brutality.
If you want to walk in the battle footsteps, you start in Boston Harbor, you disembark in East Cambridge, you march to Harvard Square, then through today's, you know, present-day Arlington, all the way out Battle Road to Lexington and Concord, and then all the way back again. All of that 36 miles saw the battle unfold.
Lexington was really an accident. Concord was a skirmish, and it was really skirmishing until they got to the village of Menotomy, now Arlington. But really in Arlington is where it really developed into a full-scale battle. This is where the fighting really became very ferocious, very intense. It was of a scale that no one was expecting.
It went into people's popular consciousness as Lexington and Concord. 90 years later, Longfellow comes along and memorializes those two towns' role in it.
Listen, my children, and you shall hear of the midnight ride of Paul Revere on the 18th of April in 75.
And the story is set.
The battles at the North Bridge and at Battle Green and Lexington were hugely important, but they happened before all the militias could get here. So they were humping to get here as fast as they could from Bedford, from Billerica, from all over the place. They were hiking in here. And this is where they were able to get before the British came back down the road. The British went up the road in the night. You know, at dawn they were at the Battle Green. Then they went out to the North Bridge to try to claim the arms that they thought were there. And then they started fighting their way back.
The Crown forces on their way back, every time they encountered resistance, they hoped it was the last set of resistance that they would receive.
The Royal soldiers were a real mixture. They were led by professional officers, some of whom had joined for military careers, some of whom had joined up just to further their own political standings. Lord Percy, probably the best soldier that George III had in all of North America, based upon his competence and his skill and his experience. Percy's troops, though, the majority of them were on their first deployment. They had never seen a shooting war. They had been encamped on the Common in Boston and drilling and getting bored and wondering what they were there for. This was their first real march out into the countryside. There had been a couple before, but this was the long one. This was the one with a very clear objective. Find those traitors, Sam Adams, John Hancock. Find the guns and the ammunition they've been storing and the gunpowder. Find them, bring them back here, get back to Boston Harbor by dinner time.
And what happened is about the time they hit Menotomy, which was then where the countryside stopped and settled land started becoming clear again, well, that's where everybody was waiting for them. A great deal of the fighting. They were fighting all the way back, but the sort of pitched battle was really here. This is where they took the biggest hit.
More and more Minutemen would arrive, more and more militia would arrive, and the fighting took a more brutal scope and scale as it went. And by Arlington, it was very, very intense.
The battle in its entirety was publicized just as fast as the Colonials here in Massachusetts could write up their version of the story and get it on a boat, a fast boat to London.
I think very important for people to understand that this is where it really went down.
By the time the exhausted Redcoats reached Menotomy on their return trip back to Boston, they considered anyone moving inside a home like this a sniper, and they would shoot to kill if necessary. Nearly every home left standing, especially along Massachusetts Avenue, sustained smashed windows, wrecked doors, and bullet-riddled walls. The Battle of Menotomy would later be described by some historians as a very horrific and murderous street fight. And after it was over on April the 19th, 1775, the air here in Arlington was thick with the smell of gunpowder. The wounded and dying were crying out in agony. It was now time to bury the dead. Massachusetts and the other colonies quickly learned the hellish realities of war on April the 19th, 1775. The British regulars who survived that day would not soon forget it. The Battle of Menotomy was over, but the Revolutionary War had just begun.
We are also told there will be civilian reenactors in this year's battle. They'll be easy to spot. They'll be out of uniform, of course, running for their lives. You'll be able to find all the events leading up to the reenactment on the Arlington 250 website. Visit arlingtonma.org/arlington250. Again, that's visit arlingtonma.org/arlington250.
We already know that the roasted granola at 1346 Mass Ave has outstanding coffee. But did you know they also have something stronger to help all of us get through these dark, cold winter months? How about a nice cold winter stout? The Roasted Granola has been teaming up with the Arlington Brewing Company to serve all kinds of brewskis every Friday night at 5 to 10 p.m. from February 2nd through April the 26th. And how about some entertainment to go along with that cold one? ACMi News correspondent Amanda Lucius paid a visit to the Roasted Granola this week and found out the coffee, the beer, and the entertainment are the perfect elixir to the daily grind.
It's Friday night, and I'm reporting to you from a popular downtown pub. Nope, this is the Roasted Granola Cafe in Arlington Heights, where once a week, an event draws thirsty visitors from all around town. But what is bringing all these people together?
It's all about community and getting to share a beer with friends and neighbors and so on.
Just getting out of the house with our baby, a big adventure in town, which was nice and accessible.
My family's on vacation this week and I'm solo, so I'm out here to meet some new people and have a good time.
It's really nice to have a place so close to home that has some really low-key evening events, and we love the community being able to come out and do this.
The pop-up tap room, which has been happening on and off since December 2023, serves artisan beer from Arlington's first brewery. Arlington Brewing Company was founded 3 years ago when town local Tom Allen decided to quit his job as an engineer to pursue a career in brewing.
During the pandemic, I ended up spending a lot of time out with the kids on playgrounds and stuff, and spent some time on the playground with my business partner, Matt. And he and I were kind of in the same place with respect to our jobs at the time. We weren't really being fulfilled by what we were doing and thinking about doing something new. And I told him, I said, I had this business plan on the shelf for a brewery that I did a million years ago, and I don't know, that would be fun. And he was super intrigued. So we dusted it off and he took a look and made a bunch of tweaks, and we just jumped in right after that.
Tom concocts a big part of his IPAs and lagers in a brewery in the basement of his Arlington home. Him and his business partner, Matt, constructed the facility themselves after experimenting with a makeshift brewery in the backyard.
Step one was to figure out how to transform myself into a pretty good home brewer to a good professional brewer. Mm-hmm. And so it was just a lot of practice. And so from day one, we made the commitment to brew twice a week. Mm-hmm. And we've been doing that for 3 years now.
But it isn't just about the beer. Having been a dry town until about 15 years ago, Arlington still lacks bars and pubs where locals can mingle. With Arlington Beer, Tom wants to meet Arlingtonians' eagerness to go out and come together without having to travel far.
People who live in Arlington tend to be really proud of Arlington and want to support things and businesses that are in Arlington, and so we wanted to tap into that. We're really committed to this town. Like, these are our friends and neighbors. It's the community that we know. It's the market that we know. Mm-hmm. And we really want to be here in town.
And Arlington Brewing Company is only adding to a growing network of moms and pops around town. In the last few years, small businesses and community events have been opening up left and right after a series of closures during the pandemic, much to the delight of Arlington residents.
I feel like they're popping up more and more, which is really fun, especially like the ease of access to the information on like Facebook and stuff. You get to see all these things come up, and it's nice to be able to be a part of it.
I think there's been a lot of change, a lot of turnover, a lot of places closed during the pandemic, a lot of new places are opening. I live in East Arlington, There's a bunch of new places opening up in that area right now.
Some ideal businesses down in the center had to close during COVID, and things are starting to come back, and I think I'm optimistic that it's going to be pretty good going forward.
Well, everybody's going to say there can always be more, but I think they're doing a great job, and a lot of the new stuff that's coming in, you see new places coming in on Mass Ave, and I'm really excited about it.
And if you're excited about local businesses, it doesn't get much more local than Arlington beer. Tom even harvests the hops for the Bike Path Pale Ale right from the Arlington bike path.
And when they're ready in the fall, we go pick them and then we put them in the beer.
Not to mention, lots of the different brews are actually named after Arlington landmarks, like the Foxy Librarian, a reference to the Fox Library in East Arlington.
As we were brainstorming names for beers, we had a big long list and we wanted to have things that related to Arlington. So we've got Robin's Farmhouse Ale. We've got Spy PA, which was named by members of the community last summer. We had a big contest to name that beer, and Spy PA was the number one vote, and it's perfect.
Because if there's one thing that all Arlington residents have in common, it's their town. At the pop-up tap room, visitors old and young from different professions and backgrounds all share common ground.
I think people come for a place to have more than just a beer. You know, they like to see some live music and chat with people.
Well, true to Arlington form, it's been great. About 30 minutes ago, this place was crawling with toddlers. They've all gone home for dinner, and now a lot of the older next generation is out here to have a good time. It's very classically Arlington, I think.
Here it's more of a community vibe. You've got the art on the walls. It's more of a, like a special, like sort of holistically represents a town more than just a bar.
I mean, really, the goal is to spread joy, and the vision is just the good people of Arlington getting together and having kind of an excuse to spend time with each other and enjoy each other. And beer happens to be a really good conduit for that. But the beer part is really, it's a kind of the almost a lubrication. We make amazing beer and it's important to have amazing beer, but really it's about the connections that we're hoping to make.
If you also want a chance to tap into your local community, the pop-up chat room at the Roasted Granola is happening Friday nights through the end of April. For ACMI News, I'm Amanda Lucius.
For more information on all this coffee, beer, and entertainment, here's the website, www.roastedgranola.com. That's www.roastedgranola.com.
Just in time for Easter, did the Regent Theatre have a show for all of us? Ted Neely and Yvonne Elliman, the headliners in the play and movie, Jesus Christ Superstar, wowed the audience at the Regent Theatre this week, performing all their hits. Not just Superstar, but both performed and sang in plays and movies that helped define a generation, like Hair, Tommy, and Saturday Night Fever. Ted and Yvonne reunited for one performance only at the Regent, Thursday, March 28th. Prior to the performance, we had the chance to talk to these two musical legends.
I only want to say, if there is a way.
Well, we love singing together. We don't have that opportunity too often, and so it's one time we had to take advantage of it and come see everybody, and we got songs from both of our different careers, and of course we come together on Jesus Christ Superstar. And yeah.
Welcome to Arlington to you both.
Oh, thanks
Thank
for having
you
us.
Very much.
Hey, it's tough to do these when you're in your prime, these kinds of songs, and they held up great, and you know, to hear songs from Superstar, to hear them do the songs that they performed in the film and for so many years,
with the video running in the background, it was.
And the band was excellent.
Very moving.
Everything was great about it.
I just really, really enjoyed it, and I loved the whole thing. We had the pleasure of meeting Ted and Yvonne before the show, and just two sweet people. It was just really, really nice, especially on Easter weekend. You know, it was just a perfect, you know, confluence of all these things. So we really enjoyed it. We just can't say thank you enough to both of them, and certainly to the region to bring this kind of a show here. Thumbs up.
There was a family who came in, and there they are, the four of them, and this beautiful little girl. You know, so I talked to the dad and the mom and the new dad and mom, and a little bit the lady says, "Honey, did you want to say something to Mr. Neely?" And she goes, "Mm-hmm." And she said, "Well, now would be a good time." "Okay, Mommy." So she stepped out in front of her mom, and she said, "Mr. Neely, you are my Jesus." And then she ran behind her mom.
Oh, my God. You can't get a better compliment.
Oh, no. Dad, the chills ran through your body, I bet. Oh, my goodness.
Years later, they are still wowing audiences worldwide. Want to know what's happening at the Regent for late spring / early summer? Just go to the Regent website, regenttheatre.com. Again, that's regenttheatre.com. Have you ever wanted to learn how to take great videos with good lighting and creative camera work? Did you ever wonder how we get our news stories or set up our in-studio interviews? Or would you just like to learn how to tell visual stories? ACMi is your place for one-stop shopping. We will be holding a series of workshops through April all about good visual storytelling. Our staff here at ACMi will teach you everything from basic and advanced camera work to lighting to news ethics and interviewing. Interested? All you have to do is email info@acmi.tv and look for all the workshops we will be doing. Again, that's info@acmi.tv. Take your pick of a TV topic. Again, the ACMi TV workshops started in March and we already have people signing up. We hope to see you there. That'll do it for this week's edition of ACMi News. I'm Summer Maxwell.
And I'm David Palomar. Thanks as always for joining us. Do you want to see how we put together the newscasts here in Arlington? Stop by and pay us a visit right here at 85 Park Ave on Thursdays afternoons between 3 and 5 p.m.
And if you have any news tips for us, stay tuned. In just a few seconds, you'll find out how to contact us.
Meantime, we will see you back here next week. Take care.
You can always check out our latest segments and newscasts on the web at acmi.tv/news. And don't forget to like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter and Instagram at ACMi News. Make sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel as well. You'll find us at youtube.com/ACMi News. If you have any news tips for us or wish to become a citizen journalist, we'd love to hear from you. Email us at news@acmi.tv or stop by ACMi Studio A at 85 Park Avenue.
ACMi productions are only made possible with your support. Visit patreon.com/ACMi to learn how you can help.